schedule for this evening or for the subsequent Thursday evenings that we'll be gathering here today. And so if you do hear the fire alarm go off, I'd ask that you please leave your belongings here and calmly invite, calmly proceed down the stairs, maybe not quietly, down the stairs and out the door immediately in front of you. So that will not be the door that most of you came in through, it will be the door immediately in front of you. And there are staff around as well to sort of guide you. In terms of toilets, most of you will be aware, but just in case for some of you who aren't, if you go up one flight of stairs, there's a door immediately in front of you, there are toilets there, or alternatively, down one flight of stairs, there's a door in front of you and there are toilets in there as well. Every week, we have drinks from 6:30 to 7, before the lecture rather than after, so in the coming weeks, please do come join us for a drink, as well as a bit of a nibble. We will be running every Thursday, except for the, I think it's March 29th, we'll be off for Easter that week, and we'll be back the following week. All right, and for those of you who are registered in the first lecture and maybe aren't in subsequent lectures, do drop me an email if you'd like to attend. We are also recording and live streaming the lectures as well. Okay, so we'll get started. This evening and this term, we're having our Director of Studies, Mark Hallett, sort of give us a behind the scenes, behind the curtains look at sort of all the work that is involved in putting together some of the magnificent exhibitions and sort of museum displays that are sort of at our fingertips here in London as well as in the country. So Mark will be going through some of the exhibitions that he's worked on, as well as with colleagues. So we'll have some guest speakers, some really great guest speakers coming up over the next couple of weeks. So give Mark a round of applause.
Thanks very much indeed, Nermin. And thanks so much for all the help that you've given all of us in organizing this this series of lectures. And in fact, this series originates in a conversation that I did have with Nermin a while back when we talked about the way in which the public lecture course had grown from a course that was initially only taking place in the autumn, and then we thought it was because there was a demand for it and people seemed to be really finding it interesting that we'd extend it into the spring term. And looking at this spring, we were wondering what kind of topic might make sense for us to do. And Nermin pointed me in the direction of the fact that we have this big exhibition that my colleague Sarah Turner and I are curating at the Royal Academy in the summer that opens in June, called The Great Spectacle, 250 years of the summer exhibition. She said, well, you know, this could be the year of the exhibitions, and maybe you should talk about exhibitions during the spring. So I crazily agreed at that point. It seemed a long time away, but it's very, very exciting to do this, because over the next few weeks, we're going to be really exploring exhibitions in a number of ways. And just to preface the discussion tonight and for the whole term, I think what I'd like for us to do collectively is to think about the very different ways we might interpret exhibitions. How do we interpret exhibitions? We're quite used as art historians and members of the public to interpreting individual works of art or a film, perhaps, or a novel. But interpreting the exhibition is a different kind of thing. And there's been a lot of work in recent years from scholars and critics thinking about the most productive ways of doing that. So again, collectively, it'd be really interesting to talk with you over this next few weeks about that process, about the kinds of perspectives we might take on exhibitions. A second question that this and tonight especially raises is the question or the challenge of how can we reconstruct exhibitions that we know about from the past? In what sort of ways in this digital world that we live in might we start thinking about innovative modes of recreating or reconstructing the exhibitions of the past? At the end of this lecture, I'll give you the first very crude and basic stab at doing such a thing for an 18th century exhibition. And then, as Nermin said, over the next few weeks in particular, we will be, rather than looking back, we'll be looking forward at three exhibitions. So next week, I'll be joined by Christine Riding, who's head of exhibitions at the National Maritime Museum in Greenwich. And we'll be talking together about a show that we co-curated back in 2006-07, a show that opened at the Louvre, went to Tate Britain, and then ended up being displayed in Barcelona, a show focusing on the work of William Hogarth and the career of William Hogarth. It was a really exciting exhibition to be involved with lots of challenges and fascinating stories that I hope you'll be able to come back next week and hear about from Christine and myself. And of course, that's an exhibition that focused on a historic topic, William Hogarth, of course, one of the great 18th century British artists, but also it was a monographic show, focusing on an individual artist, which of course is such a familiar category of exhibition that we're used to. The following week, I'll be talking with you all with my colleague from the Paul Mellon Centre, Sarah Turner, about that show, The Great Spectacle, that I mentioned that we'll be curating this summer, and it hasn't happened yet. and I hope it will happen, and I'd be a bit astounded if it didn't at this stage. But I thought it'd be interesting for you to find out about all the challenges and the opportunities and the questions that we asked, not only in putting the exhibition together, but in thinking about the catalogue, all the paraphernalia that goes around a contemporary exhibition, and also thinking about this amazing project that we're involved with, which is called the Royal Academy Chronicle, which is about chronicling all the different years of the summer exhibition. So I thought that might be an interesting thing. And also that's interesting because it's a historic show that comes right into the contemporary, because it's the whole history of the summer exhibition from 1769 to now. And also, of course, it's a thematic show rather than one that focuses on individual artists. So very different challenges, very different kind of exhibition. And then after our Easter break, we'll be returning to talk about an exhibition that I'm curating, in the autumn at Yale, at the Yale Centre for British Art, of a contemporary artist called George Shaw. Some of you may have know about him. And he's someone who was an artist at residence at the National Gallery for the last 2 years and is now putting some new work together as part of a big retrospective exhibition that's going to take place at Yale. So I'm just going to show you some slides. That's an installation view of the Hogarth show at Tate Britain that we'll be talking about next week. This, very differently, is an installation view of the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition from 2015. Quite a famous year. A number of you will remember it, I think. Famous partly because of this very vivid way in which the exhibition was coloured and presented, that was organised by Michael Craig Martin in 2015. Then after our Easter break, as I said, we'll be turning to this forthcoming exhibition of George Shaw. There is an installation shot of his work at the National Gallery for his My Back to Nature show, which opened at the end of 2016, I seem to remember. So I'll be here with George. So great, we'll have an artist's perspective on what it's like to work towards an exhibition. And it is absolutely fascinating. Working with contemporary artists, and I'm sure a lot of you will know this, so many of them, and George is very, very much, this is very much the case with him. He works the exhibitions are like the chapters of his career. Each exhibition is a project to which he works, and then that opens, it all happens, and then the next stage. And so you can really, with some artists, and especially with Shaw, you can really break down their careers, almost as if it's into different chapters of a story around the exhibitions that they've made together. So that's the next few weeks. But tonight, what I wanted to do is to return back, as the title of this lecture suggests, back to the 18th century and right to the beginning of exhibition culture in Britain. I thought it'd be interesting to root ourselves in what exhibitions were like when they first began in Britain. And the earliest surviving image that we have of an exhibition of any kind in Britain is this one. It's a print, or a mezzotint print, which represents, in a mildly caricatural or satirical way, but also in a very accurate way, the summer exhibition that was held, or the annual exhibition that was held by the Royal Academy in Pall Mall in 1771. And so this, in fact, was only the third ever summer exhibition. And it's right at the beginning of the story that Sarah and I tell in The Great Spectacle. But it gives you a sense of the early exhibitions and of what was typical of an early exhibition hang, particularly in the 18th century. And it's worth remembering, the first ever exhibition of contemporary art in Britain opened in 1760. So by the time this image was produced, the whole phenomenon was only 11 years old in Britain. As a number of you all know, in France, they had the Salon exhibitions taking place in alternate years. They stretch back to the earlier years of the 18th century, and even in some ways back into the 17th century. But in Britain, there'd been no exhibitions that had really taken place until 1760, and they almost overnight transformed the whole art world and the whole calendar and timetable and dynamics of the art world. A kind of new kind of visual experience for lots of people, and it's interesting. Just before I just popped back to my office to check how many people came to the 1771 exhibition, 22,000 people came which may be nothing compared to the great blockbuster exhibitions of today, but given the smallness of the art world and of the London population in comparison to now, that's still quite a substantial figure. And you can see this image by Earlham and Brandwen dramatised that sense of the exhibition being a crowded, quite heterogeneous place where men, women, children, sometimes, as you'll see later, dogs, cluster together and huddle together to look at the work on display. And I mentioned it's mildly satirical. We do get images of stooping connoisseurs, people looking not only at the paintings but also slightly flirtatiously at each other through microscopes, through magnifying glasses and from behind fans, flirtation going on as well as connoisseurship. Sometimes those two things overlap very, very closely. And you'll also get a sense, I think, as I said, of the social mix. This was not only a phenomenon that was geared to the very exclusively elite members of British society. It was something that was opening out to a broader public. So right from the start, exhibition culture was very much an urban phenomenon. It was something that appealed more broadly than the traditional elite patrons of art. And it was a bustling, crowded, vital, vibrant, commercial enterprise. People were paying a ticket price, they paid a shilling to get in. They picked up catalogues. They wandered around, as you can see in this image, with the catalogues to explore the work on display. But it was especially important, of course, for artists. As I said, overnight, the exhibition became a place where artists promoted themselves, competed with each other. They became these venues for competition, for emulation. They became the event. These annual exhibitions became the event around which the whole artistic year would often be structured. So artists would work through the winters in preparation of the portfolio of works they'd send to the annual displays, particularly at the Royal Academy. But it's worth remembering that at this point there were still two other major exhibition venues and exhibition societies operating in London. So it had become quite a phenomenon, the whole exhibition culture of late Georgian or late 18th century London. So we're going to focus on three exhibitions that I've researched about. A number of you will have read about, and I think they'll help us explore some of the issues around these early displays. The first one is the Royal Academy exhibition of 1784. And why this is so interesting for us to explore, and we're able to know a lot about it in quite a lot of detail in comparison to other exhibitions of the period, is that we have an amazing set of three watercolour and pen drawings and pencil drawings by someone called Edward Francis Burney of three of the walls of the great room at Somerset House where the Royal Academy exhibition now took place. So in the early years of the display, the Royal Academy's displays had taken place, the summer exhibitions had taken place in Pall Mall, in rented premises. And then in 1780, the Academy itself and its exhibition space moved to Somerset House. And you reached it through climbing the steep stairwell of stairs at Somerset House that you can still climb today if you visit it and visit the Courtauld Galleries at Somerset House. And then at the top of that stairwell, you'd walk through an anteroom, which itself was crowded with pictures, and then you would walk into the great room, which had been specially built and designed as a grand exhibition space with this light flowing in through those window panes that you can see at in the upper register of the image, bathing the display in natural light. And you can see it was a really spectacular venue for the display of art. I'll just quickly run through the three drawings by Burney. So this one is of the west wall. The wall, you can see that it incorporates a doorway through which you walked as you walked into the great room from the anteroom. This is the west wall of the great room. Then we see Burney's drawing of the north wall. I mentioned the dogs earlier on. There's one in the corner. You might spot it down there. But I'm hoping that you're just absorbing the very, very different kind of display that we had in that period compared to what we are used to in exhibition displays today. And it is fascinating that for the period, this was a much more familiar kind of hang, not only at these exhibitions, but in places like country houses. Some of you will have come to the Country House public lecture course that Martin Possel organised, and there, and over the last few weeks, we've been having seminars which deal with art and display in the Country House, and there often you would get these crowded displays, these almost collage-like hangs of works in a heterogeneous, various way, crowded together on the walls. So certain kinds of privileged visitor would maybe associate these displays with that. kind of setting. Of course, the French salons were also busy with pictures on the walls in this very crowded kind of hang. But also, more familiarly, in London itself, the coffee houses are often crowded with prints displays where the images would be not only spilling out across all the walls, but spilling out onto the pavement outside. There are print auctions, there are print sellers where prints would be, again, covering all the walls and spilling out into the windows and beyond the windows into the pavement in early 18th century London. And so, and auctioneers too would typically display a whole variety of works in this kind of way. So this kind of spectacular collage-like assemblage was a familiar way of thinking about and looking at pictures, a familiar kind of visual experience in some ways, but in the great room it was heightened by the fact that this was all paintings, this was all contemporary art, and it was all produced by figures whom the audience, many of the audience would know about and have read about in the papers. And again, another interesting aspect of the exhibition culture is that with exhibition culture we get the beginnings of criticism, art criticism. There's bits and pieces of art criticism earlier than the exhibitions, but it's the exhibitions that generate what we think of as art criticism, that the newspaper editors, the journal editors of the period, recognising the interest in these exhibitions on the part of this large public, and the audiences grew from 22,000 up steadily through the 18th century, recognising that interest, that metropolitan interest, started introducing criticism and reviews into the newspapers. And so we get the beginning of that figure that we know of as the art critic. So this is the North Wall, which we'll be returning to. And this actually is the wall that you'd have seen as you walked into the Great Room in 1784. And it's this one, it's a wall dominated by this huge altarpiece that the artist Benjamin West had produced for the King's Chapel at Windsor. And then also an interesting little detail, do you notice that fireplace that's directly facing us? That's where the miniatures were displayed. So beneath this huge altarpiece that kind of breaks all the bounds of the room and of its symmetry and of its layout, you also have this cluster of smaller pictures, smaller works. Many, if not most, produced by women, fascinatingly. Miniature painting of the late 18th century was dominated by women artists. And so that's an area where you would have the chance to look at portraits produced by women. So this is the East Wall. It's really weird. The fourth drawing, if it ever existed, has disappeared from sight. So we don't have the South Wall. We have other images. We know that Joshua Reynolds' great painting of Lady Sarah Siddons' The Tragic Muse hung right in the centre of that wall. But we don't have a really complete Burney drawing yet. So if you're in an antique shop or wandering around and you see something that looks rather like these but of a different view, give us a shout. Martin and I will be so excited. We'll come racing to you, we'll take you to lunch, and then we'll just in return for that drawing, that'd be a lovely present for us. So these are the three. So this, what's amazing about this set of drawings, though, even just that there are three out of the four, they give us a fantastically detailed insight into the character of an 18th century exhibition. And so I thought we'd just look at this one in some more detail to start thinking about the ways in which the display was structured. And again, as some of you will have known through the reading, you'll know that they're in the Great Room at Somerset House, and it was really important there was this line, or what was called this moulding, that ran across the whole room about 8 feet higher, just above head height, slightly above head height. And you can see it. Do you see it there running across underneath that great, that huge portrait in the centre by Reynolds of the Prince of Wales? So this moulding would run around the entirety of the room, and the pictures above that, again, to repeat things that you will have been reading about, above that line, the paintings would be attached to this kind of scaffolding made by joiners that the Academy would hire for the occasion, and that would be lent forward. So all those pictures above the line would be leaning forward to enable the viewer in the room to get a better view, even of those works that were really high up near the ceiling. So they all tilt forward. And if you look at either side of this slide, you can see the images tilting forward, can't you? So the line was really, really crucial way of structuring the display, and it ran around the entirety of the room. And soon people were very, very regularly and commonly talking about pictures being above or below the line. And there was a real hierarchy. And this is where the hierarchies begin. There are hierarchies all over the place in relation to the display. There was a sense, a clear sense, that more important and larger pictures would be displayed above the line. Smaller and sometimes less important or less privileged or prestigious genres of picture would hang below the line. So grand portraits, like the one you see here at the centre, which is Reynolds' portrait of the Prince of Wales, would typically be straddled and be placed above the line. So would history paintings, which were seen to be at the pinnacle of the artistic hierarchy of the period. As I said, smaller pieces, sometimes landscapes, not always, would find themselves below the line, smaller scale portraits. And you can see it's another kind of interesting hierarchy here, at least on this wall. I don't want to extrapolate out too much of this, is a gendered one. Because if you look just below the line and look across at the images that hang just directly below the line, you see portraits of women over and over again in between the landscapes that you also see and the one genre piece you see on the right. Whereas above the line, if you look at the pictures around that central triptych, you see they're dominated by male portraits of clerics, clergymen, actors. Another kind of hierarchy that often interestingly establishes on the wall is that the people who are really at the centre of society, the most important members of the society, will typically enjoy the most privileged positions on the wall. And it's almost you can do a class reading of the wall where those figures who occupy the middling ranks of society will often find themselves not right at the centre, but not right on the edge too. And then occasionally you'll find that genre pieces are, interestingly, there's one there below that maritime painting on the right, you see. They'll occupy the fringes of the display, if you ever find the poor in the display at all. So there's a kind of pictorial hierarchy or genre hierarchy of different pictorial categories on the wall. But of course, as you might imagine, there's an artistic hierarchy too, expressed here. What you'll typically find at the Academy displays is that all the senior academicians, and it's the same today, will grab all the main places, all the privileged positions on the... I shouldn't have said that because this is being filmed. It's recorded. Sorry, I didn't mean it. It's not true at all. But all the major academicians and senior academicians in the late 18th century would typically claim privileged positions on the wall. And of course, Reynolds, whose image you see there right at the centre, was the president of the Royal Academy. And he'd also produced a portrait of the Prince of Wales. And interestingly, the royal portraits were typically, or the most important royal portraits on display at any given exhibition, would typically be found on the north wall. That became, when you walked in and looked to the left in the great room, you'd see typically, almost every year after year, a portrait or portraits of members of the royal family. But you'll see that here, the pictures on either side of Reynolds' portrait are by, respectively, on the left, our left, by Henry Fuseli, another major, I think he was already, he may well have been professor of painting at this stage, but certainly a senior and a respected academician. On the right-hand side, a painting, actually a painting of an apotheosis of the prince's siblings who died young, by Benjamin West, who'd go on to become the next president of the Royal Academy. So those grand figures within the academy would typically claim the central positions on the wall. And that finds itself expressed throughout the display, that the more senior you were as an academician, as an artist in that period, the better positions you might get in the display. And of course, being right at the centre and above the line was seen to be the most privileged position of all. So if you were someone who's just beginning a career, maybe imagine yourself as a young, struggling artist who's come to London, and submitting a work for the summer exhibition, not yet a member of the Academy, not yet even an associate academician. You might send something in, maybe rather modestly sized too, that's another thing to bear in mind, that if you sent something in huge and you were this unknown upstart from Exeter, don't know why I chose Exeter, but just they had a kind of alliterative ring about it, because we were talking about Exeter last night, that's what it was, then you would, if you sent in a huge picture, that all the academicians would go, who does this person think they are? They'd expect a nice little portrait, and maybe then if you were lucky, you might find yourself squeezed in the exhibition display's edges on the wall. But you can see how much they spread right across the display. The people were used to looking at pictures not only in their own right, but side by side, but often talking about in the criticism about the relationships between adjoining pictures. Artists themselves are incredibly sensitive to the fact that if they had a really spectacular, dramatic painting right next to theirs, that they'd be knocked out of the water by the power of the adjoining image. That's why varnishing days came into play at the Royal Academy. Later, it gave people a chance to make sure that their pictures didn't die on the walls, because that's one of the great challenges of this kind of display. On the one hand, the Academy exhibitions and the exhibition culture generally gave you an amazing chance to display your work, to promote yourself, to advertise your practice. On the other hand, there was always the danger that your own works would be submerged, swamped, lost in this sea of images. And so the exhibitions became very, very important in shaping practice and shaping the ways in which artists would not only think about the ultimate destinations of their works, the houses, the institutions in which their pictures might ultimately end up hanging, but also for that impact they were going to have in the exhibition space itself. And Reynolds and Gainsborough, all the great artists that we know from this period, were masters at that idea of how to exploit the exhibition space for maximum visual effect. And Reynolds was no exception. And I think just to get a better sense of the ways in which the dynamics of these pictures and these displays worked, it would be worth focusing briefly on two artists and two works. Before doing so, one other thing I think would have struck all of you is how symmetrical the display is. That if you look at this picture, it always reminds me of a kind of a cardboard box that's been opened out and out. That it's that if you and it's astonishing that remembering this is a display that's put together not by an individual, not by a curator, as we're more used to doing today, but by a hanging committee, which of course is still the case at the summer exhibition. This is a committee who they're the people who arrange and organise the display. They're the authors, or maybe more appropriately call them the editors of the display. They edit the hang, and they create it. And in doing so, crucially, there were all these issues about the politics of the academy and making sure that Joshua got a good place on the roll, otherwise he'll come around. We know that Joshua Reynolds walked around this exhibition in 1784 on the Sunday before it opened, checking that his pictures looked okay. And if he hadn't been happy, I'm sure he'd have said, let's move them to make sure that my pictures are right in the right place. We've got a report of him wandering around the empty exhibition space, checking out where his pictures had ultimately decided, as if he didn't already know. So where was I? Sorry, I've lost my thread of thought. So there's the politics of the artistic hierarchies, the politics of you couldn't put a huge history painting below the line. It wouldn't look right, let alone fit. But also there was the considerations, the practical considerations of where one could squeeze pictures in, and also the look. There's a very great concern about the overall look of the display. And here you can see that sense of balance and symmetry generated by the two marine pictures that hang on the line, or above the line, on either side of that central. Those are three entirely unrelated pictures, you might say, by Reynolds, Fuseli, and West at the centre, but they make up this kind of triptych, don't they, at the centre of the wall, which itself then extends outwards to those marine paintings. And it's astonishing if you look around the way the walls and the upper reach of the wall, look at the ways in which the portraits have been displayed so that they turn towards the centre and they kind of mirror each other. On occasion, actually, we realised or found out that Burney tweaked things so he'd even in this drawing, he would sort of tilt his figures even closer to the centre, so it created this beautiful symmetry. And no doubt, partly because we don't see many people milling around in front of this display, it does have a sense of order and balance and symmetry that's slightly artificial. But certainly, this is exactly where those pictures in that year hung. But I mentioned about artists trying to exploit the exhibition hang and exploit the displays for their own purposes. And I mentioned Reynolds, and of course I'm going to talk about him briefly. I find it very hard not to still, after all these years. But right at the centre, as you see, you've got this painting of the Prince of Wales, and here it is. I'm not going to talk about it very long. It was an extremely controversial picture, and it's one that Reynolds seems to have created almost as a great, as a kind of propaganda exercise. Fascinating. This is produced in a year after we'd lost the American colonies, a year of disaster, or the aftermath of a national disaster, in which there was great criticism not only of the government but also of the king, his father, with whom he got on very badly, about the way in which Britain had allowed the colonies to slip away in the way that it had. And so Reynolds produces this portrait, which was actually intended initially to be hung in the 1783 exhibition, but was ultimately kept until the 1784 exhibition. And as you've seen, was put right in on display right at the centre of the North Wall. And it's interesting because pictures like this, it's also worth thinking about the ways in which exhibitions operated through memory. So people seeing this picture, and Reynolds knew this, and they said this in some of the reviews, would think of it as a sequel or relate it to earlier pictures by the same artist. And 2 years earlier, Reynolds has exhibited this very dramatic portrait of Colonel Bannister Tarleton, he's again a very controversial figure, but a military hero of the American wars. And in certain ways, and someone said this, the portrait of George Prince of Wales is rather like a sequel to this one. It's almost as if he's pulled the sword out of its scabbard and is operating in a similarly heroic way as this great, this martial figure from the wars. So the image of Tarleton lay behind, in certain ways, would have lain behind not only Reynolds' own creation of this image of the Prince of Wales, but in terms of people's memories of earlier portraits they'd seen in the same space just a couple of years ago. Ah, look, this is operating according to the same dynamics, this dynamic military portrait. course, George Prince of Wales had never set foot anywhere near a battlefield or near a fight in his life. He invented uniforms like a kind of dandy that he wore on occasion as for effect rather than for any real military meaning. He was notoriously someone at this stage of his life who was almost permanently drunk, a dissolute, and continually in the newspapers for all the wrong reasons, for his drinking, for all of his relationships with the high and the low of London society. A terrible reputation in certain ways, and one definitely in demand of rehabilitation. And this is an image, you could say, in which Reynolds and the Prince together are trying to work to rehabilitate him and to construct him as this great heroic figure. Someone indeed who might even follow in the footsteps in his future life of figures like John Manners, the Marquess of Granby, one of the great military victors of the Seven Years' War at the middle of the 18th century. And you can see the ways in which Reynolds' later image of the Prince of Wales draws upon and recycles much of the imagery of this earlier heroic portrait of this great general. But as I said, it was a disaster. It was probably the most criticised painting that Reynolds had ever produced, because ultimately, although he'd seen this as a painting that would dominate that north wall, this is an image that the painting itself bestrides that wall confidently, even arrogantly, you could say, as the Prince of Wales does. He was hoping that this would be a display and an image that would not only rehabilitate the Prince of Wales' reputation, but also demonstrate his continuing excellence as a great equestrian portraitist. And the impression I think that he was hoping to have was that his picture and that swaggering figure of the Prince of Wales would, as I said, dominate all the figures and all the images around it. And also, what's also fascinating about looking at this work is that this drawing, is it remembering that this is a picture of a display, an exhibition that took place, as I said, in the immediate aftermath of the American Wars. And look how gung-ho it is. It's got this prince at the center wearing a uniform and wielding a sword. Then it's got these images on either side of the military or the naval victories the relatively rare naval victories that had taken place in which Britain had won. And if you look around the wall as a whole, you'll see picture after picture depicting naval victories. So, and then underneath the Prince of Wales's portrait, there's an image of, quite interesting, there's an image of a Derbyshire view landscape by Philip de Loutherbourg, in which actually on horseback we have a benevolent figure giving money to someone who'd been wounded in the American Wars. And it's an image of the kind of the England or the Englishness that the Prince of Wales is imagined as protecting in this image. So it's quite interesting the dynamic between the Prince of Wales and this imagery of patriotic, martial heroism and all the imagery that surrounds it on the wall. But as I said, people didn't find it convincing. They found the mismatch between this heroic image and the reality or the perceived reality of the prince didn't fail. So this was an exhibition project or an exhibition strategy or intervention on Reynolds's part that rarely for him didn't work. And even more disastrous that year was the intervention or the planning of another leading figure, Thomas Gainsborough. And this is a really fascinating story, I think, about the dynamics of the Royal Academy exhibition. Because that year, we have a letter that Gainsborough wrote to the Hanging Committee, in which, very helpfully, he actually drew all the portraits that he was sending in, saying, "These are all my portraits." I think he says they're already framed, so they're ready to go. And I think, they were all sent to the Academy, and he was fully expecting them. He was with Reynolds, the other great leading exhibition painter of the period, and he fully expected them to be displayed. But he made one characteristic but fatal request, Gainsborough did of the Hanging Committee. He said he wanted that picture that he sketched in the top left-hand corner. It was a full-length portrait of the three eldest princesses, the daughters of George III. Outrageously, it was cut down. I think someone here might know. I think it was cut down in the 19th century, and that's on the right is what we have left of that painting that Gainsborough produced, which was initially a full-length, showing them all, as you'll see in a moment, in full figure. And luckily, there survives this engraving of the original painting on the right. So he produced this painting of the royal princesses, incredibly elevated sitters. It's a Royal Academy, as I've been talking about, the ways in which the royal figures would often find themselves as part of the display. And so Gainsborough said, of course, the picture is at the moment being looked at by the royal family, and they all think it's wonderful, and I'll be sending it. And in fact, I think he said that this one's a bit later than the others, because it's at Buckingham Palace or wherever it was. It's being sent over. All fine. It would normally have been perfectly happily exhibited. But he wrote to the Hanging Committee, he said, I want to make one particular request for this picture. I want this picture to be hung, not where it would normally be hung, but I want it to be hung across the line. So he wanted it, half of it to be above the line and half of it to be below the line, pretty much. And it is really fascinating because I think one of the things about Gainsborough's work that he was famous for and he really realised that people appreciated him for was his really delicate, intricate brushwork. This amazing connoisseurial pleasure that one has even today in enjoying the close-up view of the brushwork. And interestingly, if you imagine it, and here what the spectators would have had the chance, if it had been hanging below the line, to appreciate the dazzling way in which he painted these women's dress or dresses. This is a portrait about intimacy, the intimacy of these three sisters, but he also wanted a very intimate viewing experience. He wanted people to come up close to it and to be able to enjoy it right up close, right in front of their faces. So he wanted the lower half, at least, to be below the line, so you would see the figures themselves and even their faces close up. On the other hand, it wouldn't have fitted below the line, and it would have been entirely indecorous for a picture of the royal princesses to be hung below the line, because that was the place where you put lesser pictures rather than higher ones. Because of its status as a royal portrait, it had to be above the line. But he was worried that if it was too high above the line, it would lose that visual dynamic of intimacy and close-up looking that he prized. So he said that if you don't hang it across the line, I'll withdraw this picture and I'll withdraw all the other pictures. So the hanging committee had a real dilemma, what to do. And ultimately they stood firm and they said, well, who does he think he is? Why should Gainsborough imagine that he can break the rules of the display? This line is an important part of the great room. It structures our whole display. Without it, it's almost as if everything would collapse without that structure. And so they said no, he withdrew all of his pictures and he never exhibited at the Royal Academy again. So that's interesting. It's just interesting, I think, the ways in which artists were engaging with the displays, trying to find ways of manipulating the space and the experience of the displays, but not always succeeding. Yeah, I've begun with two failures or stories of failure. Now, in that same year, 1784, took place the second of the exhibitions I'd like to talk to you about. This is an exhibition that was created by and organised by someone called John Singleton Copley, an American artist. Again, some of you will have read about him. And what was fascinating about Copley, he'd come across from America, where he'd been a successful portraitist, and then very quickly, in the 1770s, established himself as a leading figure in the Academy displays. Astonishing portrait, a painting of the Watson and the Shark that some of you all know, that he exhibits at the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition, as we think of it now. And it created a fantastic, made a huge impact and created a reputation for himself that he continued to build upon. But what he realized as an artist was that that the Academy was getting all the benefit from these annual exhibitions. So the Academy would charge an admissions fee, all that money would go to the Academy itself. So artists would put their works on display, and sometimes they'd already been sold, or sometimes they'd be advertising. They wouldn't make any direct money from the experience of being part of the Royal Academy exhibition. So what Copley did, in a very innovative and interesting way, and one that's really set this, you know, the beginnings of the modern exhibition in some ways, he said, well, why should I do it there? Why don't I set up a one-man show, a one-painting show, initially, and I'll hold an exhibition separately. I'll produce a work that hopefully will get people's interest. I will charge admission for that that exhibition. So people can come and look at the work. And then I'll also use it as an opportunity to sell engravings after the exhibition, so if people could pay to come in, look at the picture on display, and if they should want to subscribe to an engraving after the painting. So he's American, he's a great entrepreneur. I know that's terrible, I shouldn't fall into the cliches, but he really thought interestingly about how one could make much more of the exhibition environment and experience than was currently the case within the Academy itself. And so in 1781, he began this process, although he wasn't absolutely the first, there were others who tried it, but he was by far the most successful of these one-man shows, and one picture shows initially. So he exhibited a painting of the death of Lord Chatham, and the Lord Chatham was someone, William Pitt the Elder, who'd been a great political leader in the Seven Years' War in the middle of the 18th century, which was a great period of imperial expansion and victory for Britain. You know, very, very differently to the American Wars, that had been seen as a great, great success. And so, but Chatham himself had died while giving a speech during the American Wars in the House of Lords. And so Copley produces this huge portrait, well, not huge, but hugely busy portrait of a group portrait, which was also a kind of a contemporary history painting of the death of Lord Chatham in the House of Lords. And I found this print on the right that displays it, very interestingly shows the painting on display in the rented rooms that Copley had hired for the purpose of his own exhibition. Someone talked about the fact that people would come in slowly and stand in front of this image for a long period, rather like they were attending a funeral or passing a figure lying in state. So and it's a very, very different experience to the Academy exhibition or the other kinds of exhibition that on view in London at the time. It was one where you focus on an individual work, and it's absolutely fascinating. Copley obviously thinks, well, look, people will pay a shilling or a sixpence to go and see the Royal Academy exhibition, while they'll be confronted with scores of portraits, typically, lots of things to take their attention. So if I'm going to do this as one man shows, I need to produce pictures which are crowded with, in this instance, there are about as many portraits in this individual painting as you'd find on a wall at the Great Room at Somerset House. So he created images that required time to look at them. And one of the interesting things he does, he advertises these displays as taking place over, not only during the day, but through into the evening. So you could go and spend an evening at the exhibition, looking at a single image, talking about it with your friends, attending it rather like you might a theatre performance or another kind of urban entertainment. So again, it fuses art and entertainment and commerce in really fascinating ways. So there, and then actually what's also fascinating about that image on the right that you're looking at, you see there not only the people walking in, looking at the painting, but there on the left, a figure gazing at a pictorial key that Copley had hung up on the wall so people could decipher and find out about all the famous politicians and members of the House of Lords who are depicted in his huge portrait. That was in 1781. And then at the same time as the Royal Academy display of 1784, he exhibited the death of Major Pearson. And this time, he not only exhibits this very dramatic picture which depicted this this heroic death of this young soldier, Major Pearson, who'd, after his own commander had capitulated to the French after a French invasion of Jersey during the American Wars, during that period of war, had rebelled or disobeyed the orders of his commander, fought back against the French, and won this astonishing victory in Jersey where they'd repulsed the French attackers and drove them off the island. And right at the time, or around the time the event had, the victory had been won, Pearson himself had been shot and killed. And this was a topic that Copley knew was both controversial and in the news and fascinating, patriotic, dramatic. And it's fascinating, if you move back from that image of the death of Chatham to that of the death of Pearson, you can see it's almost like the logic of a sequel that we often find in films. The second image is more dramatic, there are more special effects, it's bigger, there are more things happening, more things going on to keep the attention, even as it goes works according to the same formula. And this time, rather than only having a key on the wall, which may have been the case, he also produces this pamphlet, which has this key to the central group of figures in the painting. And it's fascinating, because what you actually realise that buried in this very dramatic contemporary history painting is a group portrait, right at the heart of it, in which that you had the chance to find out who all these individuals were with your pamphlet. And it's also fascinating, I have to say, although very telling, shocking to our eyes, that if you look at the list of figures named, or you won't be able to see it very easily on the screen, that everyone is given a name except the black servant, who you see actually firing and killing the French soldier who killed his commander, whose remains nameless and is only called Major Pearson's black servant. Separated from the group, even though in the image he's right at the heart of it. But what's fascinating about this show is that we also, one of my PhD students, Arlene Lees, a few years ago found this fantastic, she was researching ladies' pocketbooks, which were very small pocketbooks, as the name suggests, that women would carry, that were published for women to carry around with them in their pockets, and that often included really fascinating array of images of contemporary cultural entertainments. And one such pocketbook contained this image of the death of Major Pearson on display. And so you get a sense of this kind of exhibition revolving around a single image. You can see how elaborate and extravagant all that drapery is. There was also there are cannons and sculpted or faux sculpted weapons around this, again dramatizing that sense of this patriotic spectacle. You see people walking in, and if we move to comparison of the painting, it's quite interesting about the ways in which Copley is really clever about thinking about the exhibition setting for this painting. This is a painting produced essentially for exhibition. And so he thinks, right, I'm going to produce a picture that if you walk in and look at it from a certain level, you're going to have this amazing kind of experience. So if you stood back from this painting, as we're all doing, I suppose, today, and sitting where you're sitting and looking at it, you get a sense of the sweep of a contemporary battle with smoke and guns and fire and shouted orders and people dying and so on. But then as you get closer and closer, you come to the centre and you come closer and closer to the figure of Pearson himself. And it's interesting, on the left, I was just thinking about this afternoon as I was looking at it. On the left, you get the wounded drummer boy reaching and pointing towards the figure of Pearson, who's right there lying at the centre. On the right-hand side, you get one of the fleeing women looking back at the centre. So, and then above the figure of Pearson himself, you get the figures looking down directly at him. And of course, if you'd been a spectator, you'd have been almost the fourth point. There'd have been the figure looking from the left, the figures looking from above, the figure looking from the right, and then you looking just a few feet away and seeing him up close from where you can see those spectators looking. So it's a very dramatic way in which viewers were brought right close up to the action. They had a chance of a very intimate, close-up look and encounter. So that you see that amazing detail of the older officer looking down at the younger fallen comrade. That distance of look would have been duplicated by you as a spectator outside it. You'd have been having a very similarly intimate look at Pearson from where you stood in front of the painting. And I'm sure that was all manipulated and organized by Copley. And it's also fascinating that in this instance, he said, well, you don't have to only, for your entrance charge, you'll not only get a chance to see the death of Major Pearson, I'll also show my older picture of the death of Chatham. So if you see on the right there, just on the right of the engraving, you see the left-hand side of the death of Chatham. And so again, it was interesting, from one painting, you had the chance to look at two, and it's quite interesting in relation to what we were talking about with the Prince of Wales portrait. Remember that earlier image of that great bald victor of the Marquis of Granby from the Seven Years' War. Well, here again you had the chance to compare a contemporary hero, Major Pearson, with a great hero from that earlier period. Different heroism of very different kinds, political, martial, youth, age, all brought together. So it was these two pictures operate in really interesting dialogue with each other at this space. As you can see, if we look at them side by side like this. Lots of interesting parallels, but also differences, to keep you entertained in candlelight through the evening until the exhibition closed at 10:30. Also, a very different kind of exhibition space that were now emerging in London, that you could go and see these one-man, one or two-picture shows, or go and look at the crowded display at the Royal Academy. And of course, most embarrassingly for the Prince of Wales, two very different notions of heroism, one that people saw as authentic and truly magnificent or heroic, and one that was seen by too many as artificial, entirely manufactured, and rather incredible. You know which ones I'm talking about. So these are two exhibitions that took place, and what's interesting, you could walk from one exhibition, and many people did, they walked from one exhibition to the other, had the chance to compare these two very different kinds of experience, two very different kinds of ways of thinking about and looking at art. The third and final exhibition is of 1792. And this was interesting in lots of ways. It was crucial at the time, but it was seen by contemporaries as crucial because it was the first exhibition to take place after Reynolds had died. He died in February that year, and he'd been seen, all contemporaries seen, a huge vacuum that had opened up following his death. And Reynolds, so he died, and there was huge competition amongst his fellow academicians to basically make sure that the next annual exhibition would give them the chance to shine and to take his place at the pinnacle of the art establishment. And so at that exhibition, we have the new president, Benjamin West, exhibiting huge history paintings like this one, The Institution of the Order of the Garter, which is about promoting West himself as the keeper of the flame of the grandest kind of history paintings that Reynolds himself was Martin Postle has written about so much, increasingly exhibited during his time as president, and especially over the 1780s. So this painting exhibited in 1792 promoted West as Reynolds' true successor, although West, of course, had been a long-standing history painter, as an appropriately prestigious president producing an appropriately prestigious kind of painting, history painting. But in the realm of portraiture, with which Reynolds, of course, was so closely associated, there was a real battle going on between the different competitors for his crown as Britain's leading portraitist. And the summer exhibition became the site for that battle. So the figure who ultimately most people recognise as winning that war, if we're going to call about it, the war of the portraitist, was Thomas Lawrence. And in 1792, he exhibits a whole raft of pictures, very various, very glamorous. And of all the exhibition painters in the Royal Academy's history, you could say that Lawrence is the most brilliant at thinking about the kinds of image that would work well in an exhibition space. And in that year, he exhibited this portrait of this famous figure, Emma Hamilton, in the role of Milton's La Penserosa from Milton's poem, L'Allegro and Il Penseroso. And then I think very, very spectacularly, he exhibits this portrait of this young, beautiful Etonian, just graduated. But you look at the way in which he's painted it, with that dramatic red jacket, that dramatic slash of white shirt or waistcoat, the low horizon that enabled the figure to stand out, not only within the image, but on the walls. And it's amazing how successfully portraits worked in the exhibition space, because they had space to breathe around them. The figures did. And so the figure within a portrait, especially against a bare sky, especially with a low horizon, stood out on the walls in a way that other kinds of figures in other kinds of art just didn't. And Lawrence was brilliant at exploiting the possibilities of portraiture for the exhibition space. So as I said, he was competing to take over Reynolds' position, as were other artists. And although he's not very well known today, John Hoppner was very much in favor of the royal family at that stage and produced and submitted no less than four royal portraits to the Academy exhibition in 1792. Again, trying to assert his claims to be not only the royal portraitist in favor at that stage, but someone who could truly supplant Reynolds. And it's fascinating, if you look at that painting of the Frederick Duke of York, look how close it is in so many ways to Reynolds' paintings. And whereas Lawrence was always seen to have a very different kind of mode of portraiture to Reynolds, Hoppner was seen in many ways to be duplicating, and sometimes to a fault, Reynolds's templates. And here, if you remember, that image of the Prince of Wales, and going back to that image of the Marquess of Granby, you look at the way in which Hoppner is trying to recycle in so many ways Reynolds's mode of royal, masculine, martial portraiture, and hoping to have the same kind of impact as Reynolds did. So these were some of the artists competing to gain attention in the 1792 Royal Academy exhibition. And we know a lot, again, about this exhibition unusually. It's worth remembering we have, for every exhibition of that period, we have catalogues which list every work. And as part of the Chronicle that we're going to be publishing at the end of May, every single exhibition catalogue is going to be digitised so that you'll be able to research every single exhibition and summer exhibition catalogue over the last 250 years to your heart's content and explore those catalogues. But in this year, in 1792, we have something extra beyond the catalogue that alerts us to the display that year. One of the members of the hanging committee that year was a professor of architecture at the Academy at that time called Thomas Sambi. And very unusually, and we're still not quite sure why he did it, maybe he was just proud of the display that he and the rest of the hanging committee had put together. He produced a series of drawings, rather like Burney's in some ways, but also very different, of not only the great room, but also the anteroom next to it. And so he did this drawing of the wall of works that surrounded this doorway from the stairwell. So, I mean, it's the same today. You still walk through those columns today at Somerset House. But you come up, you can still see that little balcony behind. You come up the stairs, you'd walk through those columns, and you're into the anteroom. And what he did was after they'd finished the entire display, he did these diagrammatic drawings where he listed all the names of the artists who produced each of those works on the display. There's the room on your left, the north wall, as you walked into the anteroom from the stairwell, with the pictures on display. There's the south wall. And there's the east wall of the anteroom with the doorway into the great room. And as you walked into the great room and swiveled round, you'd see the west wall of the great room there. You'll remember it from some of the works we've been looking at earlier on. And it's also worth remembering that the catalogues of that period included all the works listed, and there were hundreds, if not thousands by this stage, hundreds of works listed, would be all listed in order in which they hung on the walls. So once you work out which that first picture over that doorway is, you see it says Lawrence. Do you all see that above the doorway, the full length? Once you work out that that's picture number one, if you take time with your catalogue, you can work out which every picture is. Because you can match all those names to the image, the list of works in the catalogue. Because Sambi does all the walls. The north wall, the east wall, there's that fireplace. He didn't bother with the fireplace. And it's interesting, that stage miniatures seem to have disappeared from the scene in the great room. They were displayed elsewhere, I think. And then, interestingly, one realised that these were quite finished studies, because here, in the final wall, it's almost as if there's something cursed about the south wall, because in this instance, remember that we've lost one picture of the south wall from 1784. We have his initial sketch of the south wall before he produced one of those finished drawings, but this gives us loads of information. So I thought, well, look, we've got all the drawings. If I try and find as many paintings as I can we reconstruct the 1792 exhibition? Well, it was a forlorn hope in so many ways. I've tried quite hard. I haven't tried as hard. I mean, I haven't devoted my whole life to this for the last few months. But I've devoted a bit of time to it, and I found 40 pictures from that year, which you may think is good or bad, but also really fascinating. In the anteroom, for instance, I found almost none of the pictures there. They've all disappeared. They're not important. They're not important now. They've disappeared. The pictures that I found typically are the pictures that dominate the displays, the central pictures. So it's interesting that the canon remains. All the pictures that were at the center of the display, the ones we still know about, so many of the pictures around the edges have disappeared from view. If you spent the rest of our lives, all of us together, we'd probably end up with we might get to 100, but that would be a waste of everyone's time. But I found 40 so far. And so I thought, well, look, I could do a bit of a cut and paste. I could get the images, do a photocopy, digital, and stick it in. That'd be fun. But I thought, well, let's try something. What about trying something a bit more ambitious? And again, based on what's happened in our online journal, British Art Studies, where Kate Roach did the fantastic article reconstructing the 1813 Reynolds exhibition, coming up with some different possibilities of a display of Reynolds' painting at that British Institution exhibition. I thought, well, if I work with the same people that Kate worked with, who are a team of game makers, they produce video games. They're called Duck Duck Zeus. Quirky, you know, that's that world. They do games. So if I work with them, is there any chance that they could put something together that would help us reconstruct this display? And working very closely with Tom Scutt here at the centre, and hugely helped by Maysoon Rouhani, our supremo of all picture research at the Paul Mellon Centre, we were able to start putting something together.
We have some time for questions. If anybody has any questions, I can pass the mic.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just a question. You mentioned about the lower horizons and other things that made the paintings appear more appealing. Was there any other shortening or any other techniques that the artists might have used if they knew they were going above the line?
Well, you might have spotted things that really work on the walls even as you were watching this film. But one thing that was mentioned, or certainly been recognised by modern scholars and was clearly exploited by art at the time, is the power of white on the walls. That's what I think is so interesting about one of the things that's interesting about Lawrence. He knew that if he, I don't know how this works, sorry. Yeah. If we just go back to the athlete, he knew that flash of white at the center of that guy's, the young guy's outfit would really sing out from the wall. And so white was used a lot to gain attention. The other interesting, I've said it before really, but the low horizon, but I think you'll get a sense from looking at these from the film, the ways in which portraits that give the sitter room really do manage to stand free of, at least get a bit of breathing space in relation to all the pictures that surrounded them. Crucially, the subject was important too. If it was a known person, a celebrity, that certainly helped. In terms of pictorial devices, visual drama of certain kinds. There was a lot of complaint at the time about the ways in which the exhibitions had encouraged artists to work in a far higher pictorial key. They're working in with much brighter, more vivid colours to get attention on the walls. And that seems to, and that may well have been the case. It's quite interesting because some artists would also almost go the opposite and say, I'll do something very small and low key, almost to kind of give the viewer a bit of an oasis or a bit of calm in this visual cacophony of the display as a whole. So there are various strategies. I'm sure I could think of others if I gave myself more time. Thanks. Any other questions about... Yeah, sorry.
Did you say any other questions?
Not just about this, but about the... Yeah.
This is probably a really nice
No. Why was that height, the height of the line chosen, you mean? Yeah. So the question was about why was the line placed at that 8-foot height? Good question. It's very interesting. It was seen, pictures, hangings, whether it was to do with the dynamics of the great room itself, but it was seen to be, there was a perception that that would allow pictures below the line to be seen in their entirety and close up, but also that it allowed, it was a height at which large-scale portraits worked very well, that height. And I'm sure it's come from things like the country display. I was just thinking, it's made me think about that, about things like the halls in country houses, what they're called, the viewing galleries, and about the height. And it'd be very interesting to see whether the line correlates to the kinds of ways in which portraits, full-length portraits, for instance, or great history paintings were hung in country houses. I mean, the other interesting precedent I mentioned was the salon. So it'd be interesting to see whether this idea of situating the line over, I mean, there's also, it might seem horribly practical, but that issue of doing it above the door. That's not much of an answer. But that's a good question. I don't have an absolute clear answer to that question. So it's basic, but no, it's not basic. It's actually fundamental. But it really clearly, I mean, people have often seen it as structuring it really as a practical issue and allowing lots of pictures to be packed and allowing this over. You can see the overhang here, can't you? This parade of works to be tilted forward in this way. But it certainly structured the whole display and the whole viewing experience very powerfully. Any other questions at all? Yeah. Yes, that's right.
So people that hung frames, how much do they know? Because these are beautifully mirrored. So do they actually know?
No, well, in this digital reconstruction, we've flattened out all the variety of the different... but there were standard frames in which you would exhibit the works of the summer exhibition in. So there was a familiar format for exhibition painting. So, I mean, it was interesting that seeing Gaines was saying he sent his in frames, so they were already framed. There must have been, I think, an expectation that those frames would operate. That if you put your picture in a very, you know, gilded, flamboyant frame, that would take too much attention. So there was a sense of, there was a need to stress uniformity through the frames. So I think it wasn't that the frames, sometimes they would be there empty of the picture until the last moment, but other times they were sent in. So.
Yes. Themselves so beautifully, paintings mirror. Did the people who hung the frames there know, so that, you know, they're all looking?
Oh yeah. Oh no. Sorry. I see what you mean. Yeah. No. The hanging committee was very concerned to generate harmony and balance and symmetry and dialogue between the works. And so you did get these. I mean, you see it in the. I mean, here, for instance, we've got two royal portraits on either side, and they've clearly been decided that. Well, with the figure of the Prince of Wales turning inwards, we put him on the left. And similarly, the artists themselves would assume and expect their pictures, but they had certain kind of dynamics to turn one way or the other. So the hanging committee, as I said, was like an editor, and would try and make sure, I think, that... I mean, there are differences. Look at the Martin Archie. That figure's looking the other way, the wrong way, as it were. So they couldn't be perfect. But in so many ways, they try to create... It almost... What's so fascinating, it becomes almost like a group... It's like a big group portrait or like a collage where they're all individual works of art, but they all do work together as a pattern as well. And the hanging committee was very concerned to maintain certain kind of conventions, but to create something that was an ensemble. Maybe that's a better word to think of it. An ensemble that works where the pictures relate to each other in a harmonious way. Yes. Yeah.
And this sort of raises the idea of, like we have now, when the Sotheby's and Christie's schedule their auctions to be at the same time,
yeah.
So that all everyone who's interested comes in for
the same time.
One
yeah. No, but it's a really interesting term. Yeah, there was a fringe even in the 18th century. There was, I think, because, I mean, Copley, that's right. His opened after the, I think his opened in May's, so after the Royal Academy exhibition had opened. But it was certainly exploiting that possibility of figures who come in, who are interested in, because of course the Academy and art was being discussed in the newspapers at that time, the critics would be writing. So, and I mean, the other thing that Copley does really very powerfully is he advertises like crazy. So in the newspapers, he not only says, my exhibition is opening next week or 2 weeks' time and counts down the days, but he incorporates in the adverts incredibly long descriptions of the painting and how exciting it is, as news reports almost in the newspaper that would then send you hurrying to the exhibition. And then Copley is not alone. Over the late 18th century, the early 19th century, we're often finding that academicians and non-academicians were having exhibitions that kind of operated like a constellation around the summer exhibition. The summer exhibition was without a doubt, right through well into the 19th century, the dominant annual exhibition. But as other art historians have explored, other venues and other kinds of display. I mean, the word exhibition gets used more and more for displays of all kinds of exotic imports of clothes, of toys. You know, that idea that that whole exhibition experience extends beyond the world of fine art, and certainly, and also you're right about the notion of it being at the tail end of the season. That becomes very, very important. That it's, I think, it becomes one of the last events of the season, the annual season. Well into, and even today, the way in which the preview to the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition is advertised is as if, oh, come and have a privileged look at this display before the wider public have the chance to see it. Yeah. Any other questions at all? Yes. No, there was. There was a. It's interesting. It's there's a. Even the second exhibition, 1770, there was a painting that was submitted and had been accepted, which showed two friars, you know, religious friars, drinking alcohol and then it was recognised that there were portraits of two contemporary Londoners, and it was seen as not only offensive to those figures but also rather blasphemous, and so that painting was withdrawn. And we get this over, and then in this period, interestingly, we get some pictures being withdrawn for their political radicalism. Someone called, I think, William Austin, really fascinatingly, a waxmaker called, I think, Florence Wright, exhibited a work which showed, I think, the decapitation of Charles I or something like that, which was seen as really, really dangerous and was withdrawn. And so there's a lot of anxiety and tension around certain pictures and around their politics, sometimes about their religious meanings or offensiveness. And I'm trying to think of others. That's really fascinating. The Prince of Wales, I talked about having a very dubious reputation. There's a lot of debate about whether his paintings should be shown alongside some of his lovers. So there's a year in which it was known that the painting of Miss Fitzherbert was exhibited. His portrait was due to be exhibited in that year's display, right next to hers, but it wasn't exhibited at all. It was withdrawn. So scandal could also stretch into the exhibition space. Yeah, that's a very interesting observation. I guess it's quite interesting in comparison to places like Westminster Abbey or St. Paul's and places like that. It must, and of course there is a powerful religious component to much of the imagery. I mean, we saw, when we remember back to 1784, that huge altarpiece by West. Here we get a look at this fusilier that we're looking at right now. So it was, and we've seen it primarily as a secular artistic aesthetic space, but there were religious narratives running through the exhibition itself, and it straddled the, I mean, that was what's so one of the fascinating things about it is it straddles a world of high culture and of refinement and of something that deals with the higher issues in culture. At the same time, it was seen as a great big commercial spectacle. a marketplace, an advertising space for all these artists. At the same time, as a Royal Academy, it was seen also to be promoting, you know, a national school of British art that could operate alongside the great European schools. So it's continually moved around this across a spectrum of being seen as I said, a commercial event and phenomenon. And one, in fact, which would attract far too many people who were there for all the wrong reasons, to show off, to look at each other rather than look at the paintings. That was a continual satire, that people weren't interested in the art. It was all about parading themselves. There's a lot of joking about the ways in which a celebrity figure would walk in and stand below his or her portrait in the exhibition space. And that's the way, and the kind of gossipy side of things would come through. So there was that aspect to the exhibition space, even as it was also wanting to try and define itself as a space of the kind of highest liberal cultural values at that period. Amen. Yeah.
And the commercial, them as individuals, but perhaps also for the academy overall.
Yes.
The commercial engine for the exhibition.
Yeah.
Have you come across instances where they came? I mean, how are these two conflicting things mediated?
Well, it's really fascinating. In the very first Royal Academy exhibition of 1769, at that stage, the newspaper criticism was often paid puffery by journalists being paid by the Academy. And in one of the reverse reviews of the first ever exhibition, it said, "We're as a royal institution supported by royal munificence, you might not expect to be charged for this event. But we have the academicians can find no other way of keeping improper persons out." So they say, well, it's a way of keeping this a kind of a purified space or a space uncluttered by the plebeian, essentially, at that stage. And so that was a way in which the admission charge was justified, that it was seen as something that was a necessary, unfortunate but necessary requirement to keep the audience, however large, polite. Okay, it's a total myth, because the summer exhibition then, as was the case right through the Academy's history, was the main way in which the Academy was funded. And it's still interesting, even today, that we think of the Royal Academy as a state institution or a branch of the state, and we assume it's publicly funded. It's not publicly funded at all. It's entirely privately funded, and it always has been. Except right at the beginning, it was funded by it was supported by the court, by the king. But very quickly, or quite soon, it became self-financing through the revenues it was getting from the summer exhibition. So the summer exhibition was hugely important to its future, and there was a lot of anxiety about the increasing number of academicians who were doing the one-man shows, because it was like, ooh, if we're diluting our product, and people, and will our audience, the debates weren't so different as they you have today. If our visitor numbers drop, our revenues drop, because they're all going to other things. There was a lot of debate and anxiety around that issue. When Copley went, as it were, solo for the first time in 1781, Chambers, the Academy secretary, or treasurer at that time, was livid, because he saw this as something that really threatened the coherence and the fabric of the Academy as a group of collaborative academicians, which is always a bit of a facade or a myth. It has been an issue right through its history, this issue of defining itself as the guardians of the highest kinds of cultural production, and at the same time depending on the revenues from this and of course more recently other exhibitions to fund itself. And it's interesting, it's a Royal Academy, the image of the Royal Family is right at the heart of the display, and so it promoted itself as a public institution at the same time as it was a private one, and of course it also knew that having all these images of people like the Prince of Wales would attract more and more people into its rooms. So it was also a commercial selling point to have these images of these great celebrities on the walls.
Right, I think we might draw a line under the questions, if that's all right. Join us next week for the continuation of our lecture course, and if we just give one final round of applause for a fantastic lecture.